So, great to be here and great to have you here on Founder Stage. Hanno, you founded Personio for 6 years ago, and this is your first time at Slush, right?
Yeah, indeed. First time at Slush, but really impressed by the event that Mika and the team has put together. It's really nice.
I think there's a lot of startups who've been here like years and years and years, and now they're like, you coming straight on to Founder Stage must be feeling really nice. The latest raise that you did was $270 million, and Personio is now valued to $6.4 billion. I mean, for those who are unfamiliar with your company, what do you do?
So, Personio is an HR platform for small and mid-sized companies between 10 and 2,000 employees. So essentially how you can think about it is we're doing on the one hand the core HR, what Workday does for enterprises, and democratizing those benefits. But we're also doing workflow automation, so what ServiceNow does for the enterprise, we're also doing for small and mid-sized companies. And thereby we're digitizing the entire employee lifecycle for companies and really helping them manage their most important assets, their people, more effectively.
So I've heard that you actually never had a real job before this. So I was just wondering, how does a guy who never had a real job get into like the HR tech, right? So can you tell me a bit about that?
Yeah, good question. So indeed, we never had a real job. We founded a company out of university, and I guess we're lucky to an extent that we weren't just trying to solve a typical student problem, which oftentimes isn't really a big problem to solve, but we were able to look at what's really a problem in companies that is relevant. And I think one, we found out that people, and that's I think obvious to everyone you talk to, but not very seriously taken, is that people are the single most important influencing factor of every successful company. And then figuring out that while all other parts of the organization have been digitized, that 70% of companies in the SME space are not using any digital technologies to manage their people was really astonishing. But then also we had the luck that we had the insight from a friend of mine that was CTO of a company of 100 people that were using Excel sheets, and he kind of gave us that little nudge to look deeper into the space. And then, yeah, we were amazed by the opportunity that was there. And I think the last 5 years was really capturing and building a product that supports all those core flows within HR. And now that we all have built that system of record, we have the opportunity to build on top of that and solve even more challenges of small and mid-sized companies.
Was it ever hard to really get into it? Because usually you need to have experienced the problem yourself before actually, I mean, most startups do, right? But before actually, well, feeling that it was your thing to solve this problem.
So I think one of the benefits of not having that experience ourselves and not having been an HR person ourselves was really that we had to take what now is part of our core values, customer empathy, really to heart. So we really had to learn from our customers because we didn't know much about the problem ourselves. So really from the day one, talk to customers, show what we had built, learn if that's solving a problem, if so what, and what else they need to get there. And I think that DNA of listening to customers, although we now by now hopefully have developed some expertise about HR ourselves over the last 5-6 years, but still I think that DNA has been remained in the company of everything we build, working very closely to customers, the way we develop also not just the product but the services, how we support our customers, always trying to listen to them very closely. And I think that initial, not knowing this space so well has helped us actually to build a better product in the end.
Mm. So I suppose when you started off, it wasn't as so easy maybe to raise money. Because HR tech is something that the media is not really picking up on either. I mean, now probably more. But was it hard to actually get through?
It definitely was a lot harder than it is today. And I'm not just talking about our own rounds, but also just the overall space and Europe and all of this, how the ecosystem has evolved. But particularly, I think for us, the early days, it was not bad that it was harder because it forced us to really figure out what really matters for us at the time. And we were able to then bootstrap for an entire year and had 30,000 in recurring revenue when we raised our seed round, which by now you raise a Series A and much longer. But I think that's crucial, and that nimbleness in the beginning of not having the opportunity to raise money and really needing much more proof points to get to a first round of capital actually helped us in the beginning. So I think that's been not too bad in hindsight, but certainly, it was much more convincing. A lot more people in the early days were saying, "Oh, this is not a big enough problem to solve, and why do you even build that at this time? It feels solved already, and it is astonishing. I think even for me today, how much opportunity there's still left. We have 5,000 customers today, which is 0.3% of just the European market, and I think that proves how big that category is. But I think it was just overlooked for a really long time and not invested enough, and therefore we're glad to be now being able to give that value to customers.
So if you talk a little bit about the beginning on when you actually founded Personio, did you have to do the sales yourself? Because I suppose you don't do that anymore, but how did you get your first customers?
Yeah, I mean, as probably every founder starting off, I was trying to get in contact with any person I could find. The good thing about HR is that every person you know works in a company, and the majority works actually in small and mid-sized companies, and you could just ask them to get an intro to their HR team, and then through that personal connection, I tried to get into a meeting and show them our product. And so the first round 100 customers was really me, not just selling, but really convincing people to use, but also pay for our product. And I do think it's really important to early on, even if it's small revenues, getting your early customers to pay for it, because then they're taking it serious and then they're actually using it, and then you get that feedback. And that's sometimes really painful feedback, because they're now having high expectations to you too, but that pushes you to really focus on solving their needs. The first 100 customers was me selling ourselves, and from those learnings we then started to build up a team, and now of course there's a much larger team supporting our customers than just myself.
Yeah. No, of course. I mean, now you have 1,000 employees, right?
Yeah, 1,080.
1,080. And I mean, you have 5 offices across Europe. Is it difficult to kind of keep the culture? Because that's usually a problem, right?
It is clearly one of the most important challenges for every company that scales to solve. I do think in this case, actually, last year when we were opening both the Dublin office and Amsterdam, and also growing Madrid and London quite a lot, COVID in a way helped us with that, because while I'm a big believer in bringing people together now as well, we have a higher flexibility for our workforce, but also we still have an office culture where we create great spaces for people to come together. But during that time when we just opened up new offices, it was actually helpful that we could transfer the culture more effectively, because everyone, whether you started in our Munich office or in Dublin, were onboarded the same way and were meeting the same people. And therefore, that cultural transfer was easier. And when I, for the first time, was allowed into Dublin or to Ireland again and was able to visit our Dublin office this summer, when we were 150 people, out of the last time I was there was just Geraldine, our chief revenue officer, and it still felt a lot like our Munich office and our Madrid office, which has been much more established, because that cultural transfer has worked well. That being said, we're now still continuing to invest in things like culture carrier, so there's from all offices across each other, people being allowed to move over for 3 months, work from that office, and thereby distribute our values and operating principles across.
So about like recruiting people, obviously everyone wants to grow quickly and so on. I mean, are you involved anything still in the recruitment process?
Yeah, still all our hires include a founder interview. So our hiring process has 5 stages. There's some deviations for more complex roles, but every general role is interviewed first by HR. Then there's a team lead interview of the person that will be future lead of that role. And then we should already be at a stage, can that person do the role? And then there are three more interviews, peer, value, and founder interview, to really figure out, does that person fit our culture? And do we feel we're raising the bar with these additional hires? And yeah, I'm still spending 20% of my time on interviews. I'm not the only founder, of course, there's the three others, but we still all heavily invest time ourselves.
Yeah, I did speak to one of your colleagues here earlier, and she said that she had to go through 7 interviews before getting the job. I think that's more than 4 years in the military, so I think that's high standards. I mean, do you see that as, is your tool that you are actually doing helping you to actually recruit well as well, or do you need to have hands-on?
So I think, first of all, it's important to say that I'm not smarter than anyone else in our recruiting process. The one thing I can add, besides, of course, having a ton of experience of having interviewed thousands of people by now, is that I can help with avoiding some of that urgency bias, because of course I'd love to fill all of our open roles as quickly as possible. And by the way, if anyone is not a founder and wants to search a role, we have 800 open roles out there. However, with these roles, with that growth in mind, I'm detached enough that I can spot where we're making shortcuts and where we're lowering the bar because we really need someone. And it's really painful, and I think that's one of the harder things to do if you're growing really quickly and you need every person you have on the hiring plan, ideally yesterday already. And one of the hardest things for you to do then is to remind yourself that hiring someone below the bar and hiring someone just because you need that person that might not fit your culture or might not be the right person for the job will really have exponential effects down the line. And therefore, as painful it is to go through that stretch of waiting another month, waiting another quarter, and some roles, we've waited 2 years until we found Ross, our chief people officer, but now we're really confident that he's the right person for the role. And I'm so glad that we didn't settle somewhere in between for a person that's lower standard. And that's not just on the executive level, but for every role across the business.
Well, other startups that do actually, expand abroad and so on, they have some problems because maybe their brand isn't well known yet and so on when they want to hire new great people. I mean, have you ever had that problem when going into new markets?
We had that problem in Germany as well, and I think every company and founder of a B2B company will have that challenge. It's much easier to do that if you're checkout on Coop on stage or Spotify. Of course, like a lot of consumers using your product, not in the early days, but still over time. So as a B2B company, you always have a bit of that challenge of how do you build up your employer brand in your home market, but then also when you enter new markets. And I think one of the things which our director talent, Martina, back then, head of HR, did early on, which I didn't thought was necessary, but really paid off by now, is hiring employer branding role early on to really help us get the word out. And it feels like an incremental effort, but it's the same as with marketing. You need to invest in brand early on. You need to do those investments, and that then only pays off a year down the line. But then, of course, you're more known, and you will see that in the conversions of your applicants, but also in the just overall funnel. Mm.
So now you obviously, I think you are in Germany, obviously, and also the UK, Netherlands, Spain, but you're now looking to enter the Nordics and also the, Italy and France, right? So is it the same issues that all companies have, like small companies, in HR?
Yeah, so Nordics, we actually have a big established team already selling to the market and quite some customers here as well, which I'm really excited by because I do think there's a lot of tech-affine companies. In fact, the Nordic market for us is in a way more interesting than the German market from their tech affinity. So companies are much more forward-thinking here than they are in our home market, which is great to see. But when it comes to the adaptation of our product, of course there is some areas like our contract creator, which is the same because you can customize your contracts and all the fields that need to be signed, and that doesn't matter for which language or country is behind. But when it comes to areas like the payroll or even things like absence tracking and how vacation rules are being made, every market is a bit different and we need to adapt to that. Luckily, we always knew that we didn't want to be a German solution, but we want to be a European player, and therefore we needed to early on think about how to architecture the system to make that happen. I think that's one of the benefits when you're a European company that will soon go into multiple markets, as opposed to a US company that oftentimes only focuses on that one really large market for a while, and then they might be at a much later stage when they for the first time enter new markets, and then all of a sudden they have to realize what the challenges that come with it. So I think training that muscle early on, both from the way that we build product, but also the organization, the different offices, is something that is really helpful and one of the benefits of being a European founder, I believe.
So why stick to Europe? Because that's really your thing, right now at least.
So I think there's two answers. One, we believe the European market is massive when it comes to SMEs. And that's, again, one thing that's often been overlooked. So you always think like, oh, if you want to be a large software company, you need to go to the US. And that used to be true and is still true for some categories. If you, for example, selling to software companies, yes, there's much more software companies in the US than there is in Europe. If you're selling to enterprises, large enterprises, yes, there is more really large enterprises in the US than there is in Europe. But if you're selling to small and mid-sized companies and you're quite agnostic to the sector they're coming from, like we are, then there's actually more SMEs in Europe than there is in the US. So we can build a larger company only focusing on Europe than only focusing on the US and have more impact than digitize a market that's much more underserved. So these are some of the reasons to focus on Europe for now. We're also quite patriotic when it comes about the continent and really up-leveling and proving that you can actually build world-class leading and category-defining companies from Europe, based in Europe, for the European market. That being said, I don't exclude that we ever go outside of Europe. I think it's about focus for now, not doing too many things at the same time. But I wouldn't exclude that we, over time, go beyond Europe, the same way how some companies that focus on the US for a really long time at some point go beyond US. But we do believe that there's a ton of opportunity, a ton of companies and organizations across the continent here, which we can continue to support until then.
So, what about your investors? Because you obviously have quite a few. I mean, what do you think that, I mean, do you have an American investors, for example? They don't want you to just come to the US then to take on their market, no?
We have several US investors. So the first one was sort of a mixed one, which we got in our Series B with Index Ventures being both Europe and US. So there you could say, okay, they get Europe. But we then also brought on board Excel and Lightspeed and Meritech, which are all US headquartered funds, and also in the most recent round, three additional ones. So all of these firms are US have started in the US and have their main footprint there. But I think that's the big shift that has happened, that they've recognized how big the market is by now, where in the early days, indeed, from when we spoke with two investors in our Series A, back then there were much more people that they were saying, oh, so when are you coming to the US? By now, no one asks us this anymore. They actually say, you built your company here, and we trust that this can be a $50, $100 billion company just focusing on the European market. And I think that's the mind shift that only has happened now, and that only is starting to prove out at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, also, I suppose when you are raising quite a lot of money, the mid-level kind of money and the higher amounts of money isn't as available from European investors. So was that also a necessary to bring in American investors because of that?
I do think there's a large amount of great funds now popping up all across Europe, and that of course know the European market really well, and therefore for early stages I think it definitely makes sense to take on European money. Over time, I hope this will also translate the same way into growth funds. Currently that's not the case, and I think in apart from the fact that there's not as much capital on the growth side, it also is that those funds or few funds that are, of course, don't have the same level of experience that some of our investors. If you think of Meritech, who came on our last round, they were the first investor in Salesforce back in the days, and they now since have been pretty much in every public SaaS company they've been invested. So of course, all of these learnings, both in the firm but also from their portfolio. Next week I'll be visiting them in San Francisco, and they connect me with all their great SaaS founders. That's of course an opportunity you don't get, and that will only materialize. And I'm hoping that of course companies like ourselves can help some of our earlier stage investors build up a portfolio of companies and founders, which then convince other founders to take money from them also at a later stage. And then I think there's the challenge at a really high level, where we're getting into sort of the pre-IPO phase now, where we're getting approached from pension funds from Canada and from other places around the world. And in Europe, unfortunately, these pension funds often are not allowed to directly invest in startups. Because pension funds, you don't really care about where that money comes from. You want patient, independent capital. And I'd be happy to have the teachers' pension fund from Germany, with my parents both being teachers, invest into Personio as opposed to the teachers' pension fund from Canada. But unfortunately, they're currently not allowed. So I think that's also a shift that hopefully will happen over time.
Definitely. I think now the pensions are mainly going into VC funds, right? So it's kind of, but it's one step ahead. It was one step in between.
If even in Germany, they're currently going mainly into housing, yeah. and other things, which is also, yeah, retrieves them from some great returns.
But that is changing probably, right?
It is. Mm.
So when you then look at becoming this unicorn, I mean, I suppose for the last couple of races at least, you haven't had to kind of win the investors over, but they have come to you, right? So when was the switch there, do you think?
So I think there's an overall shift in industry that, of course, much more founders are in a strong position because there's just so much capital. And if you're also at an earlier stage by now, a good company, you oftentimes have 5-6 term sheets. I just spoke on the phone with one of my angel investments a while ago that is currently raising their Series A, and they have 6 investors, some from the US, some from here, all wanting to pile in money. And therefore, I think that's some of the shift. I do think that COVID has driven that further as well, because it made the whole industry more global, and it made people invest based on Zoom calls, which didn't happen before, and of course therefore allows you as a Helsinki or Munich or anywhere else based founder to raise from a fund that sits in New York or somewhere else. But for us personally, I think we had some interest around Series A already, but then from B onwards there was a lot of like preemption where people really wanted to get in quickly with processes that were really short and very efficient, which of course, besides the fact that you get good valuations and great funds, it also just allows you to be very little distracted on fundraising. And I think that's really the real benefit about that. It's not about the capital that sometimes can be distracting, but really being able to, as a founder, spend less time on fundraising and less time on convincing investors allows you to spend more time on your customers and building a product.
So most first-time founders, they don't always fail at the first startup, but they don't do as great. I mean, we can look around. I mean, even like Daniel Ek, he founded a couple of startups before actually doing Spotify. And Niklas Zennström had a few ones before doing Skype. Do you think that it was harder for you as a first-time founder to actually succeed in this?
I think it's a really good question. I think there's, as with most things, there's headwinds and tailwinds. Of course, as a first-time founder, and many in the audience will know that, you don't know anything, right? And therefore, a lot of things you have to figure out for the first time, where of course, if I were to start a company again, I would know a lot of things to do, how to do them differently. So that are some of the tailwinds. On the flip side, however, I think what helped us as a founder team, and also me personally, was that we were quite naive about a lot of things, and therefore we took a lot of advice quite literal. So take the very simple one: people are the most important asset of your company, so never compromise on recruiting. If you're being told that as a first-time founder, you believe that everyone takes recruiting extremely serious, and therefore you should do as well. Over time, we realized no one really tested it as serious as we're doing, but it really paid off to do so. And so I think some of that naivety actually helped us and was a benefit for us. But then ultimately, and that's true both for us at Personio, the same way for Daniel at Spotify, timing is such a big part of you being successful, and timing is such a big part of luck. Of course, we were at the time thinking this is the right time to start Spotify, and I'm sure Daniel would have said, for us, Personio, and Daniel would have said this was the right time to build Spotify, but really only in hindsight you can tell that it happened to really be the right time, and I think that's something neither first-time founders nor repeat founders just get right automatically, but there's a lot of luck involved that your thesis at the beginning actually pays off.
So are your co-founders still at Personio, or have they checked out?
No, one left around 2 years in because he didn't enjoy the scaling part as much, and he also wanted to move away with his girlfriend. But the others are still on board, so we're still working together.
So what do you think? I mean, do you ever get like itchy feet and want to, you know, sell and just move to Spain and get a better suntan, or I don't know. I mean, what do you think? I mean, how long do you want to stay on at Personio?
Well, first of all, we have an office in Madrid, which I love to visit, and we have amazing roof tours. So everyone that looks for a job in Madrid, highly recommend to check out our office there. But besides that, I don't really don't feel that itch. I think I'm 31 years old. That's probably also one of the benefits if you're a first-time founder, that you have so much more leeway just in your life. And I don't really, if I were, and I don't plan at all, but if I were to sell the company today, what else would I do then? And I don't think money is something that makes you happy in life particularly. So what would you then do? And I'm really enjoying my role. I really enjoy the company. And I really, truly believe that we're at the very early beginnings of the opportunity at Personio. And that's what excites me. And that's the opportunity you had of building, of proving to build that in Europe you can build a leading software company, and that in Germany so far SAP has been the only large software company we really have in the country, and that compared to the many software companies in the US is still small by now when you see how many have overtaken it. And I think that opportunity is what excites me, and therefore I don't have any horizon of how long I want to build a company. We at some point will take Personio public, but that also is not an end game or a goal we're striving towards, but just a milestone and another financing round with different kinds of investors ahead of a much longer journey.
Yeah. So if you look back over this 6 years, I mean, it's just 6 years, but what have been the most difficult decisions you had to make during those years?
So I think some of the most difficult decisions actually come at a point in time when you think it should get harder, because in the beginning you're so much constrained with a lot of things that within those constraints you're of course pushing the boundaries, you're trying to do a little bit more with what you have, you're trying to kind of convince that one additional, so there's a lot of this hustling motion. And then when you get to our stage where you have a lot of resources with not just the financial resources, which are ultimately limitless because you can always raise more money, but also the team of over 1,000 people, you believe that, oh, it should get easier. But now actually the decisions you take matter much more and are much harder to take, because where you actually focus these resources and where you invest them and how you make sure that you're not, just because you do have a lot of resources, do a ton of things in parallel and thereby not get anything done, but really that level of focus matters much more than it did in the early days when you were pushing the boundaries and hustling your way through. So I do believe when it comes to, for example, our strategy, that's really hard conversation we always have in regards to what are the main few things we want to make, and how do we get the organization to understand that, and how do we get all of ourselves aligned on we need to nail this, and this is secondary to it. So I think these are some of the really tough areas and challenges you face when you get to scale.
So what are you most worried about will happen then? I mean, your nightmare scenario. We're not going to end on that, but anyway.
Well, it's a big challenge to get the focus right, but I don't think it's a nightmare scenario for us to focus on prior two as opposed to prior one. That's just one thing where we also can learn. I think the only nightmare, one area where, of course, as a probably every software company or platform, but also especially when you, like ourselves, have very sensitive data, of course, a data breach is one you're always working hard to make sure it never happens. So if you think about nightmares, it's probably the one thing I would think of.
So, okay, so if you would just think ahead then, what is the next big thing for you?
So I think one of the really big things we recently started off was creating our own category. So we've started digitizing, developing an existing category and democratizing HR software to SMEs. What we've done a few months ago was launch what we call people workflow automation, which is that layer on top of everything we do that actually makes HR go beyond HR and actually includes people processes that run across the entire organization, that run through tools like Slack, like Microsoft Teams, and like many others, and have them automate across the business. And that's something that's a new category to think that in an integrated way. And that's a really exciting area for us to invest and really not just get companies from zero to one, but now accelerate on the basis of that of that digitization, which we have achieved with many of our customers already. And that's really exciting for us to do. At the same time, of course, the internationalization and going beyond across Europe is really exciting, and seeing the teams here in the Nordics and other areas really get traction, find customers and bring the same value to those that we did in some of our initial markets is great to see.
Are you ever worried about competition?
I'm very little worried about competition, not because I think we are just better than everyone else, and that's not something we should be worried about, but I do think in markets like ourselves, where the market is so large and the relationships you build with your customers are so enduring, we have many of the customers that I signed up in 2015, most of them are still customers today, and therefore it's not about now where we're a food delivery business and we're grabbing back and forth that one customer that on a one day orders with delivery here on the next day with Wald or Lieferando or whatever, but really we're building long-lasting relationships, and therefore I think for us, focusing on competition and what they are doing would be much more detracting us from that focus I just spoke about with regards to our strategy, with regards to our customers, and really truly solving their needs. And therefore, I think if you're operating in a software company in a similar space like us, it's really about focusing on your customers, and then that determines whether you're successful, not your competition.
Yeah, there's a big space. So with that, thank you very much, Hanno Renner, for joining me here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mimi. Great to meet you.